nice beaches and also nice conference. And today I would like to tell you about, so this work is unpublished, but I would like to take you about a different way to bring a system into a topological phase and to manipulate it using super lattices. So, and please ask questions during the talk if you have. So we already heard about these ideas that when we think about one-dimensional system, we have a wire with spin orbit coupling, we'll have this structure of the spin orbit coupling, and we put it in proximity to a superconductor. This green stuff is a superconductor. In addition, if we put the magnetic field in this direction and tune the chemical potential to this point, we expect to have at the end of the sample, at the end of the wire, a Majorana states that we'll first discuss in relation to P-wave superconductivity in the quantum Hall region by Reed and Green. Now, experimentally, there were two, I would say, waves of experiments. The first one was in 2012. There were experiments in Delft and Weidmann in Lund, where a zero bias peak was measured in this kind of samples. And recently, there is a new wave of a few new experiments that come from both from, I will show you some detail, both from Copenhagen and Delft. And the main, one of the main obstacles in this problem is somehow we have to tune the chemical potential to be at the right place. And you have to overcome this obstacle somehow. And this periodic structure that I will describe actually let you control the chemical potential and bring it to the right position. Now here in this experiment at Copenhagen, they use a different idea. So they grow a thin layer of aluminum on indium arsenide wire, and they form, I feel that, can you hear me? It's fine. So what they have here is a small, thin aluminum layer on top of indium arsenide wire, so that, and they can control with gates, they form actually a quantum dot with a superconducting correlation. So now when I change the gate, I simply change the number of particles in the dot, and what we expect to see, so what we see here, the black lines are the Coulomb blockade peaks in the absence of this Majorana states. So when we add odd number of particles to the sample, we have to break a pair and put one of the electrons in an excited state. And so this will be the superconducting gap where the additional electron goes to. As we apply magnetic field, this Majorana state is created, and we expect that the Coulomb blockade peaks will now be equidistant. And indeed, this is more or less what is seen in the experiment. Another experiment that somehow shows signature of Majorana at the end states came from Harvard, from Amir Jacobi group. So here, it's a different story. It's not indium arsenide, but mercury telluride covered by a superconducting layer, and they control the they bring the system into a situation when they have Majoranas at the edge by tuning the phase difference between the two superconductors, and there are evidences that may be a Majorana state there. And recently there was another thing that I thank Carsten for letting me know about, this recent experiment, again from Copenhagen. So that was like exactly 10 days ago. It was put on the archive. So here what they do is they have a 2D electron gas and they put the cover the aluminum only part in this pattern. So they have, and effectively, they have a wire connecting two reservoirs, and with a gate, since it's so thin, they can control the chemical potential in the system. And you see that the conductance is very close to 2 E square over H, as one expect to see. But what I would like to discuss is a different kind of idea or related, and then we will generalize it also to two dimensions. So the idea here is to look, and that came right from the beginning. I had several discussions with Charlie on just implementing this idea that you have a super lattice in the sample. So the idea is now that we have a gate, a thin layer, a superconductor, a superconducting part in the shape of a comb, and on top of that, we put the nanowire. So now with the gate, we'll tune easily, or rather easily, the chemical potential in these voids. The electric line will pass through the empty space, or through the space without superconductivity, and will change the chemical potential, mu, which we call mu n, on the wire. And there will be some different chemical potential, mu s, which we control, we somewhat control, but not really able to control, because there is some coupling between the superconductor and, so here mu s is controlled by the coupling between the superconductor and the normal wire, the difference in the work function, and so on. So this is something which is, we may a bit control by, by changing the coupling between the superconductor and the wire, but this is really given by the experimental situation. Mu n is easily controlled, and the idea is to tune the chemical potential to the right position by changing the potential in the gate. Now, yeah, electrochemical potential will be equilibrium, and this is the chemical potential. Of course, you have one electrochemical potential, but the distance from the bottom of it. So, and it's expected you have more electrons or less electrons near beneath the superconductor or in the regions above the superconductor and less. And so that's fine. And the imbalance is just that you will have the same electrochemical potential. Now the nice thing about this structure is, so there are nice things, and the nice thing is that you can imagine coming with a probe with an STM and measuring both the tunneling density of state and also sense the charge on the wire. So the idea is in this picture. So I didn't draw the oscillations or the lattice structure, but the idea is to come with an STM and measure both the tunneling density of state and sense the charge in the system as a function of magnetic field and mu n. And what you expect to see here, so let me define the density. If we have, if we define U, U is the particle like, you know, U and V, which appears in the Bogoliubov-Degen equation. U will be H minus IG, and V will be H star minus IG star. So I just redefined U and V in this way. And the density that you can sense with a charge sensor by, for example, putting a quantum dot on the edge of the tip will be proportional to the multiplication of G and H. And the tunneling density of state will be just the sum of G squared plus H squared. So these are two very different quantities, and this is a unique situation for the Majorana case. Usually we expect that the charge will be in the place where you can tunnel electrons. There is one wave function which has both the charge and the tunneling density of state. And here it's a very different situation. So you see that H squared plus G squared is more or less located at the end of the wire, while G times H will be all over. So if this is what we calculated in 2014, and this is the result for the charge, and this is the result for the tunneling density of state, and I think this configuration will allow one to measure that kind of system. And of course, just to remind you that when we discuss Majorana, a signature, it is always a necessary condition that to see these things that we calculate and predict. But actually, while fine-tuning an Andreev state, you can always see similar phenomenology. So the important thing is to check that the system is robust. This is, after all, the important thing about topology, that it's robust to changes. So seeing once this charge sensing and so on, it's not enough. You have to show that it's robust to changing variables in the system. This is why it's called topological state, because it's robust to small changes. So now I would like to describe in more detail how we did the calculations and what we have So I'm coming back to this model. One second. Yeah. Okay. So this is the Hamiltonian that we write as a phenomenological Hamiltonian. What we'll have is the we allow both mu x and the delta to change in space, and we so we'll have in the region, in blue regions which are not covered by the superconductor, we'll have mu n, and in the and zero delta, and in the regions when we have mu s, when we have superconductor, we'll have mu s and delta naught. So this will be the basic Hamiltonian that we will have to study. So immediately you understand that we will have this picture without superconductivity. What is going on here is that we expect to have mini bands. So this picture is without the superconducting behavior. So and the length is the length, the period of this super lattice, and we expect to a gap will open at the edge, at the end of the Brillouin zone. And so immediately you understand that there will be a few different, and we expect to have these so-called mini bands in the problem, enter into the discussion. So immediately you understand that there are three different regions. You ask about disorder effect. So we did not think yet carefully about disorder effect, but it's, of course, the disorder has to be smaller than the gap that you opened. But it's an interesting question for to understand what is the importance of disorder in these samples, but it's protected by a gap. So, but this is just the first, you know. Yeah, it's a very good point. So immediately you understand that there will be three different regions. So first of all, this is even before putting any superconductivity. We can have a situation in which the energy, the chemical potential, is sitting in the first band. This will be where the lambda Fermi, again, without the superconductor, that may change lambda Fermi, and it will be different wavelengths beneath the superconductor and not beneath the superconductor. So this is just to get the length scales, approximate length scales, and to get a feeling for what we expect to see. So we expect to see three different limits. One is when the chemical potential is here in the first band. This corresponds to lambda Fermi, much larger than the length, the periodicity length. In this situation, the wave function, the extent of the wave function is simply average over many periods. So you expect to see something which is very similar to the uniform coverage of the wire with a normalized parameters, or effective average parameters. The advantage is that you can tune the chemical potential by tuning mu n. Now, if you change the this limit will be when lambda Fermi is of the order of L. Of you have to be, of course, to put the chemical potential somewhere here so that we have electrons in the system, but some of them can come from the superconductor. And we also have a situation when lambda Fermi is much it's smaller than the L, so we'll have few few bands which are get into the discussion. And as you expect, we expect to see, you know, if we are the first band, this will correspond to having one band. If we go to the second one, we have already two bands, it's not topological, and so on. So we expect to see some alternation between topological state and non-topological state. So it's actually quite easy to analyze that using a tight binding model. So this is what we did here. So this is our unit cell now. There are a few sites which are normal with this mu n and so on, and there is this superconducting type. And this is the result for L much smaller than lambda Fermi. So the green line corresponds to, so what we plot here is fixing mu n to be zero and changing mu s. And this axis is the magnetic field. And the green line is the situation where all the wire is covered by a superconductor. So we expect to see that for sufficiently large magnetic field, we cross the critical point, And if the chemical potential is in the right place, we will have a topological sample, a topological state, namely with the Majorana states on the edge. Now, as we expect, what happens when we have this periodic structure, we simply get an average value, which is smaller because part of the sample is not superconducting. So this red line is a formula, I don't have the formula, but it's with mu bar, which is equal to R mu s, and R is simply LS over L. So this is just renormalized, as we expect, just renormalized a parameter, and this is the value that we took for them here. Now, these numbers are taken from the indium arsenide experiment. So we have a transition at lower magnetic field. This is because the effective delta is the effective superconducting gap is smaller. So this is the transition between topological and trivial. Now we can also, we did calculate the gap in this situation. And the nice thing is that the gap in the topological state, unless we are really close to the transition point, it remains of the order of delta itself. And this was very good signature that although we have this periodic structure and so on, the gap is not reduced dramatically. Another sanity check that we did was to say there is this point A, which is deep in the topological state, and this is the Majorana state. You see that it's decay exponentially and have very small support in the middle. If you go to the B state, which is closer to the transition, the overlap between the Majorana is larger. So this is the tunneling density of states. Now, this is a very important graph. So what we did here was to fix the value of the magnetic field to be equal to delta naught, the value of the gap in the superconductor. And now what happens is that mu s is given, as I tried to emphasize. Mu s is given by the sample and by the tunneling. So you may find yourself, if mu s is 4 and mu n is 0, you may find yourself, although you are at a very large magnetic field, you are not in a topological state. Now by tuning mu n, this is the point, by tuning mu n, we can bring the system into a topological state. So we can really have, we really have control on the system parameter. Yes. So this is in the limit of L much smaller than lambda Fermi. So I did not plan that question, but this is now what happened when you go to the mini band structure exactly? So when L, the length of the system, is of the order of lambda Fermi itself, then you start to see this mini band structure. So what we plot here is again the VZ is the magnetic field, and mu s is the change in the chemical potential due to the superconductor. And again, we put here mu n equal to 0 and simply change the length of the period, make it larger or smaller. So, but here we put L of the order of lambda Fermi, so you start to see this mini band structure. And the nice thing is that you somehow increase the volume of topological state. You can really get access to this, and this is reasonable. You know, now you have this mini band structure. So earlier we had only one band, and we have to tune it exactly to be in the right position. Now we have mini bands, so you may be in the right position for the first band or the second band, and so on. So it's easier to find a place where you have topological state. So this is for L of the order of lambda Fermi, and you see the nice thing here is again that the gap is somewhat reduced, but not much. You can really be in a city without the periodicity. If we cover everything by the superconductor, it will be very difficult to if mu s is very large, then it will be very difficult in the uniform case to be in a topological state, and also it will be difficult to control this mu s. But here, somehow, almost for any value of mu s, you are close to a topological state. When we go to L too large, you know, all the length scales are longer, so all the gaps are, which are inversely proportional to the length will be smaller. So indeed, what we see here, we see many, many bands, but the gaps themselves are of smaller value. So the message is that you may want to tune roughly the length of the periodicity to be of the order of the Fermi wavelengths, that for these wires, it's about 100 nanometer. We did in K-space, so it was infinite. So to get that was in K-space, and for the density of state, all the numbers here are similar. So this is X over LSO, and all the numbers are similar, so 13. Here. But I think in reality, you can really tune the parameters. You get periodic structure, you can really tune the parameters. We even have smaller value, but this is fine tuning. Yes, that's as well. Yes, they do overlap. Yes. Okay. So again, what we did here was to do to check two points of the simulation. A, which is a bad point. US is really bad. It's about 8 point something, and you are very far from the topological state. And in B point, you are lucky because you are very close to a topological state. And the question was, let us tune now mu n. This is, after all, we can tune by the gate potential. Maybe we can bring the system by tuning mu n to a topological state, although we are not in a very good point here. Here it seems that we have to change the magnetic field quite a bit in order to get to this limit. And the nice thing is that both in A state and B state, we have, by tuning mu n, we can bring the system into a topological state. There is a large phase space that allow to bring the system to. So this is just a practical way to find this topological state. So more or less, I finished the story about the one dimension. So if you have further questions about that, this is the time to ask, because now I'm going to change the subject and to speak about two dimensions and periodic structure. No further questions, so let me continue and speak about the two-dimensional system. So that was partially, somehow we start to work about that, and then I met Charlie, and he told me, look, we already have patterns of two-dimensional system. So again, the advantage here is that you can imagine putting a gate potential beneath the sample and tune the chemical potential between in the void, in the places which are not covered by a superconductor, and bring the system into a topological state. Then we expect in two dimensions that it will have an edge mode in the sample. So, so the simulation is a bit more involved, not much. Still non-interacting problem. Without disorder, so it's just straightforward. You can do the tight binding model, and basically we again will have a similar. Now we'll have LX and LY and size of the superconductor in X and Y. We'll have mu n in the blue region and mu s in the red regions. And again, we can discuss different limits of the mini band. So. I would like to emphasize that this is very important. In the wire, it was very important to put the magnetic field parallel to the wire, or actually, the important thing was to put it perpendicular to the direction of the spin-orbit coupling. In two dimensions, it's more difficult. Usually, the spin-orbit coupling is in plane, so there will be always a direction in which the magnetic field is in the direction of the spin-orbit coupling, and the full gap is not open. So what we did first was, and I will discuss that situation later on, but what we did first was to assume that there is an effective Zeeman field, not orbital field, but an effective Zeeman field in the z direction, so that a gap is opened in the system. So this is can be a result of a Dresselhaus term that exists in indium antimonide and is weaker in indium arsenide. So what we see here is basically the same thing. In the limit over LX and LY are much smaller than lambda Fermi, you simply average over the uniform situation. You have some kind of interference effect, but still the gap is very similar to the bulk value. If we concentrate on this point, we'll have this P plus IP state, which go around the system. And that should show up in a tunneling density of state measurement or measuring the conductance in an NS junction. If I put, yes, there is. I have Zeeman in the Z direction, so I assume that it's there. And the reason to have that is I assume that I put magnetic field parallel to the sample. So I don't have an orbital in. But then I have to argue why I have a Zeeman field in the Z direction, and the Dresselhaus term does that for me. And then, okay, I apologize for the quality of, it's supposed to get better soon. So earlier we have, earlier we had the situation when LX is and LY are much smaller than lambda Fermi. And here we have LX and LY of the order of lambda Fermi. So again, we have this mini band structure. And if we choose to be in this A state, then by tuning the chemical potential, we can bring the system to a topological state. The gaps are somewhat smaller. This is expected. And we have this edge mode going on the edge of the sample. Now, in principle, you can imagine or using this two-dimensional structure, if I can control the chemical potential on each island or between the islands, you can imagine creating such situation in which you have T-junction and braid the Majorana. Now, 2D, in fact, have much more than, many more options than the one-dimensional situation. Just to remind you, we know that in two dimensions we have a trivial insulator, we have the quantum hole, and we have a quantum spin hole. In two dimensions, we may have an S-wave superconductor. What I describe for you is P plus IP superconductor, and you can have the time reverse and invariant topological superconductor version of that, where you expect to see P plus IP, Majorana mode going in that direction and another one going in opposite direction, just like in the quantum spin Hall effect, and we can add on top of that a fractional states. So really, two dimensions have much more freedom and much more things that we can do and find than in one dimension. So what I would like to describe now in the last 5 minutes that I have is a thing that I'm excited about, and I think that a lot can be done in new novel states can be found in two-dimensional samples. So first of all, in all this discussion right now, until now, I did not include orbital effect at all. This, of course, will be present in the sample when I put magnetic field perpendicular to the sample. But it could be, if I'm in a topological state, each vortex will carry also a Majorana state. So the question is, what will be the experimental signature if I put, if you can find this system with these vortices which has Majoranas in the middle, and what will be the experimental signature of that? We can think about different lattices, and I will describe that for you. And of course, the most important thing is interaction effects. So let's first think about what happens if I don't have this Dresselhaus term? So I put magnetic field in parallel to the sample. Again, no orbital field. So this will be the effect of just spin orbit coupling. So if I cut the chemical potential here, I will have one Fermi circle and another one with opposite spin chirality. Now, when I put magnetic field in plane, then it, this is a result of the calculation. What it does, it shifts this inner circle down. So if I cut, look on the cut of the system in this direction, what it will have is two parabolas of that fashion. Now application, I will have two parabolas of that fashion. This is due to application of magnetic field. So the important thing is that we don't open a gap. Usually, usually magnetic field open a gap in the system, but you see here, I will always have four Fermi points, never mind how I cut, what is the chemical potential here. So I can never get into a situation where it's fully gapped and it's topological. You may have a gapless superconductivity or some other interesting stuff, but you can never get into a situation when you have a topological superconductor. So now, but what you can think, what happens is that when I apply, now that was for the uniform case. If I have this periodic structure, then what you expect is that the magnetic field will not be, the parallel magnetic field will not be uniform. It's partially screened by the superconductor islands, which modify the direction of the magnetic field. So we will have a component, a Z component of the magnetic field which is average, which is zero. But I will have a Zeeman field which is periodic. So we add, we simply, this is what we did, add this periodic structure in the Zeeman field, assuming that the orbital part, neglecting that for so far. And what you see then is that, so these are the standard structure. If you add a weak BZ periodic in X direction, so we just have this usual copies of, in order to get the first Brillouin zone, we just use copies of the original spectrum. And you see that a weak periodic field in the Z direction will open a small gap here. If we increase the field, then if it's periodic in X, it will just remove the Fermi point here. We still remain with the Fermi point there. We want to get rid of them, and then the periodic structure in the Y direction will just open a complete gap here. So simply take, if you take a sample with this periodic structure of superconductor put parallel field, it may be sufficient to bring the system into a topological state without having the need for this Dresselhaus term. Okay. We can also think about a different lattice structure. So in fact, this hexagon lattice structure, which was very important in the discussion of topological insulator, we all heard about Haldane model of particle with average flux, which is zero, but when you go to second nearest neighbors tunneling, you will have some periodic flux captured by this second nearest neighbor coupling, and that leads to a situation in which you have a churn insulator. If instead of carbon we have a Majorana zero mode, we expect under the proper conditions to have a P-wave superconductor in the sample. Now, again, I'm discussing only in-plane magnetic field. So in fact, this periodic structure is not very far from the hexagon structure. If just I shift them in this way. So here the red part is superconductor and the white part is just exposed. I can invert that. And I can add voids in this way. So if I have a periodic structure of that thing, it's very similar to the hexagon structure. So if I take this T shape, it's very similar to inverse Y shape. And actually the topology of the structure here and there is exactly exactly the same, and we also expect to see Majoranas if this was indeed 1D, if the red part was one dimension, we expect to see Majoranas at four points at the end point of the Y junction and in the middle there is a very interesting paper. Yeah, so there was an interesting paper that discussed wire construction of hexagon lattices by Jay, who is here in the audience, maybe, and Barkeshli. So the idea here is that if we include Coulomb interaction in this structure, doing a Schrieffer-Wolf transformation, you map the problem onto a Kitaev honeycomb model. And this model has a very, so here is now including interactions inside this Y junction. Now, if we don't include the Neo-Snell interaction, this is the Tori code that some of the people who developed that are sitting here in the audience. And if we include next Neo-Snell interaction, then we get an interesting non-abelian state. So what I'm trying to advocate to tell you is that actually all these states are hidden in this periodic structure, and it's our job, the theorists and also the experimentalists, to understand what are the conditions that will realize this interesting topological states. So in particular, we can also think about a novel state that was not discussed in these systems. And this is if we include this time reversal invariant topological superconductor, then, and there is, this is especially for you, then I hope that it will qualify as a sign-free problem. So to summarize, I discussed today the gate issues and how to control them by periodic structure. We also discussed several interesting situations in two dimensions. And interaction effects, this is for the future, and I think this has a lot of potential and interesting stuff. So thank you for your attention.